Many of you have heard me say before, quoting the late, great Walter John Burkhart, "All stories are true. Some are based in fact." This is a true story based in fact about two Canadian farmers. One day, the dog of one got loose and mauled to death the two-year-old child of the other. The devastated father cut off all relationship with his neighbor, and the two lived in cold, defiant enmity for years. But there came a day of fierce fire. The property of the dog-owning farmer was devastated, destroying his barn and all its equipment. He was unable to plow and plant, and so his future appeared doomed. Except, let me say it again, church, except that the next morning he woke up and found all his fields plowed and ready to seed. Upon investigation, he discovered that his grieving neighbor had done this good deed, plowed the field ready to seed. Humbly, the rescued farmer approached his neighbor and asked him if he had indeed plowed his fields, and if so, why. The answer was clear and concise. "Yes," the former enemy said, "I plowed your fields so that God can live." Did you hear that, church? So that God can live. That's a line. We here gathered can testify and give testimony that God lives. Can I get an amen? Amen. And even more, the God who lives and has summoned us to this time and place, to this season of Lent, is a God best described by Kathleen Hughes and Monica Helwig as irrevocably welcoming, imperturbably forgiving, and indestructibly reconciling. Somebody say amen. Amen. This God, this Christ Jesus, is equally clear and concise this evening. We are not to be angry. He goes past murder. He goes past the fifth commandment. We are not even to be angry. And he's not talking about those short bursts of annoyance or frustration. Rather, he is talking about the brooding, pervasive kind of animosity that can eat away at us, a kind of leprosy of the soul. This toxic poison destroys relationships and leads to malicious gossip, to character assassination, and to the destruction of lives and reputations. I hope somebody knows what I'm talking about tonight. This toxic poison destroys relationships and leads to malicious gossip, to character assassination, and to the destruction of lives and reputations. Now, lest we are tempted to excuse ourselves from such ugly behavior, I ask you to reflect on your own lives for a moment, as I have to reflect on mine. Who was the last person you gossiped about or maligned? even gathering for worship this evening? How frequently do you label or stereotype others who may disagree with you? How willing are you to savor animosity and bitterness toward a friend or a family member in order to hold on to your own hurt, your own self-righteousness, and your own brokenness and pain? Some years ago, while teaching in the seminary in Cleveland, Ohio, teaching homiletics to be specific, a student of mine, whom I didn't particularly like, decided to challenge me, if you can imagine. I told him that his homily was really quite fine, but that I found that it was a marriage homily, and the tone toward the end of it seemed to be a bit troublesome. It seemed to be a bit harsh. And he said, well, actually, I woke up this morning in a bad mood, and I thought, well, you know, when I'm preaching, someday I may be preaching at a wedding and I may be in a bad mood, and they just have to know it. I took him to task, and he said to me, you know what the problem with you? The problem with you, Father Murray, is you want everybody to preach like you do. You want us all to preach like you do. My response? Please. I couldn't possibly expect you to preach like me. You have none of my intelligence, even less of my wit, and none of my life's experience. I couldn't possibly expect you to preach like me. Oh, how easy it is to retaliate. How easy it is to turn other people into a category, rather than seeing them each as a beloved child of God. He was, for me, a reckless seminarian. But as a matter of fact, he was a child of God who happened to have seen things differently than I. What Jesus is suggesting this evening is that all our contrived convictions and pastoral pontifications about reconciliation mean absolutely nothing, sound and fury signifying nothing, if we are not committed to healing and forgiveness in our own lives. And my mama didn't raise no fool. It ain't easy. It ain't easy. It ain't easy. It ain't easy. As one author noted, in order to make peace with your enemy, you have to make war with yourself. In other words, we must battle our own hateful instincts. To paraphrase Jesus, before you offer your peace plans on the altar, first go and be reconciled to your brother, to your sister. For love, according to the scripture, is not irritable or arrogant or boastful or rude. Love does not insist on its own way, but bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. In order to make peace with your enemy, you have to make war with yourself and be able to say, I am not irritable or arrogant or boastful or rude. I do not insist on my own way, but bear all things, believe all things, hope all things, endure all things. Hardcore Christian love is not about affection and friendship. It is about forgiveness and reconciliation. It is about a law deeper than litigation. It is about the law of grace and the power of the resurrection. This day, if any of us feel estranged from God, it is not because God has moved away from us. It is because we have moved away from God. We have become distanced by all our anger and brokenness and disappointment in relationships in this world. In Little Gidding, T.S. Eliot writes, "And all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well when the fire and the rose are one." Yes, when all manner of creatures are one, and all manner of Christians are one, and the broken and the fearful world and its creator are one, and the church and her Lord are one, then all will be well, and it starts here. Thank God for that ever-present and not quite yet gift of reconciliation. In the name of the one in whom such reconciliation is found, and no other, Jesus Christ, to whom we cry out, "Oh, fix me, oh, fix me, oh, fix me. Fix me, Jesus, fix me. Fix me for my long white robe, sing church. Fix me, Jesus, fix me. Fix me for my going home. Fix me, Jesus, fix me. Fix me from all hurt and harm. Fix me, Jesus, fix me. Fix me from all greed and lust. Fix me, Jesus, fix me. Fix me from my deepest fear. Fix me, Jesus, fix me. Fix me from all anger, Lord. Fix me, Jesus, fix me. Oh, fix me. Oh, fix me. Oh, fix me. Fix me, Jesus. Fix me. And so fixed, then we will be a Christian. This is the good news of the gospel. May it be so for you and for me, let the church say.